every year, an announcement is made that has an enormous impact. A country is announced as the host of the next Conference of the Parties, or COP, which means that this country will be responsible for hosting one of the world's largest annual UN environmental meetings, with thousands of participants from all over the globe. If your country is chosen this year, you'll need to get started right away, make a clear plan, and move forward on all fronts. In a very short time, the eyes of the world will be upon you. Thankfully, there's a dedicated group of people who are there to assist you to get started and who will partner with you throughout the entire process.
One of the most revealing statements that we make in our meeting with the host country is saying, this is a United Nations conference hosted by your country. And in a way, it's almost arrogant, but it's true. The group that actually makes the proposal to host the COP are normally the politicians. They have attended several COPs as participants, but have, in most cases, never experienced the behind the scene. Almost 90% have underestimated what really goes into it. Before even making the proposal, I would start doing the work. I would start by deciding who's going to do this, how much is going to cost me, what are the implications of doing this, can I handle this, and then make the proposal. That's how I would do it. But of course, that's an ideal work.
I'm very, very grateful, and in fact, I think we're very privileged to always have years in advance offers coming in to host a COP. But I am convinced that every host country doesn't have a full understanding of what it means, and they enter a little bit like all of us enter marriage, without really knowing how difficult this is going to be.
When I was told that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs would ask me to organize COP15 in Copenhagen, I said, well, sure, I'll do that. I had no idea how large the task would actually be. There are many times during the COP when I said, why have I ever ventured into this? You're just amazed at the numbers that you meet, how big a task this really is.
Although I don't deal with the substantive agenda of the conference at all, an intimate understanding of that agenda is very important, because you're creating the environment where the negotiations is taking place, and so you need to understand that to create that environment. The number of rooms, how they are set up, the number of microphones, the number of staff, the opening hours, the closing hours, what kind of meals are being served. You can't come as a host country and say, no, you know, we are in Argentina, we have to eat meat. You cannot do that.
We always send a team, a technical mission, to look at the host country option. It's a combination of what is the venue for the conference itself. It is the ease of transportation, very, very important, in particular when people are working till 2 in the morning, they want transportation at that point. Also security. It's the ease with which people can get visas to get into the country. We're talking about the entire package that allows for 10,000 people, if that is what we have, to go and do their work.
We are expecting about 40,000 people around Paris COP, about 22,000 delegates in the conference, and more or less the same number outside of the conference. And we have decided to have the places for those people really next to the conference, which means that really it's a city we are building. We have to have transportation, we have to have hotels, we have to have food. We need to be sure that people will have a bank, a post office, and whatever. A COP is a city.
One thing that we really, really were stressed about was the number of participants, that we were overwhelmed by the number of people who actually came, and we simply faced lines to get into to the center for a couple of days. So say, what can you do about that? Well, the only thing that could have been done was much closer attention to that one detail, that one critical parameter for success is how many people at what time, and have very, very clear communications with the UNFCCC about that issue, because it's a joint effort to make that a success.
Psychological dynamic in which you work always affects your product, and that's true for us as an individual, it's true for a system like this. If I'm in a good mood, I'm probably able to do more and more efficiently during the day than if I'm not in a good mood, and that's very true, in particular if you have 10,000 people in a good mood. So the fact that the venue needs, first of all, to meet very, very clear specifications that we have from the negotiations point of view. The trick, however, is how to meet those specifications every time in a completely new, innovative, and creative way. Because there's never one venue that is a copy-paste of the venue of last year. Every venue is completely unique, and our secretariat team has been able to develop what I think is a miraculous skill of being able to comply with all of those specifications in completely different environments every single year.
People sometimes ask me, how come you can do this over and over again? Actually, I've only done each one of them once, because every one of them is a totally different event. There are common denominators, of course, but each one has its own character, its own location, its own challenges, and you can't compare them.
In the early phases of COP preparation, you need a completely different set of skills. That's the bureaucrats that need to conduct tenders, that need to do budgets, that need to do calculations on transportation and dinners and all this stuff, do protocol. But that's a different set of skills than the ones that are needed at actual implementation of the COP. That's more like going into battle. We need to have very clear chains of command, but at the same time, very decentralized authority that the guy in charge of accommodation also has the mandate to say yes and no to delegations and so forth, so that the head of logistics only deals with emergencies.
This year, we have an incredibly brave host country that is constructing a whole conference center for us, which is the first time that we have ever had that. If a country already has a conference center, like, for example, we had in Doha, absolutely the world's top best conference center, then the logistics is much easier.
Choice of venue is, of course, very central, and it's not something the host country does on its own. It's something you talk with the UNFCCC about. Important is size. You need to estimate, is this able to hold the number of participants, including press, including observers? Security, is this a place where you can have the necessary perimeter security? Your national police can deliver that. The green and sustainable credentials of the venue is also important, because that'll be difficult to change. But it's important that you're able to this very critical community of climate negotiators and press, that you're able to demonstrate that you're hosting a sustainable conference. And if the conference center in itself is not sustainable in the way it provides services, you are off to a bad start.
In accordance with UN rules and procedures, the host country is expected to bear the entire cost of setting up the conference. It is an expensive undertaking, depending on the size of the COP, depending on the facility, depending on where it is, about $100 to $180 million. This has been the range so far.
You have to put forward a realistic budget from the beginning, your best guesstimate. The alternative, and we've seen this many times with some of the hosts, is that you put forward a partial budget where you're leaving some items out. And when you go back to Parliament and ask for extra appropriations, the headlines will be costs are out of control. It's a scandal, and the automatic reaction on that from politicians is criticism. Do the complete budget from the beginning and put a lot of effort into that to make sure that you have every item in there that's going to cost you money.
Financing is part of it. It's not a small element. Also, a COP brings a lot of money to the country that organizes it. It's important because people are going to be in hotels, they are going to rent cars, they are going to use the public transportation system, and so on and so on. So it's a big issue, but you have to finance it and go through the political process in order to finance the organization.
as the environmental issues grow larger, more and more persons, people, participants, and groups are becoming part of the COP. You have finance, which has come into the process. You have human rights is coming into the process. Gender and women is coming to the process. The effect of climate change on adaptation, mitigation. There are always new themes coming in, and they bring with them different people. So it moved from being just an official meeting of the members of the convention to sort of like the Woodstock of environment.
A COP is a global gathering. So you have people from all countries in the world trying to find solutions. That in itself is a little bit exhilarating. It is truly the world community coming together. There are more people who have stakes in such a COP than you immediately think. Of course, there's a UNFCCC in Bonn, which is an absolute vital partner for you. There is also the city, the host city. There are private companies, there's the NGO community, there's the media. The list goes on and on and on.
The challenge, I think, is the quantity of participants. NGOs are divided into 9 major groups, and they are UNGO youth, environmental organizations, business organizations, researchers, trade unions, local governments, gender, farmers and indigenous peoples organizations. And they come with all different backgrounds and different agenda to push. And we have to kind of make sure that they have equitable access to limited resources in terms of meeting rooms, sidemen slots, intervention opportunities. We try to promote their engagement with the negotiators and also provide platform for themselves to network.
The largest number of participants at the COP is actually going to be the observers. And there's a little bit of a tendency for them to feel a little bit neglected compared to the negotiators. And you'll see this physically also, with some parts of the COP are actually closed for the NGOs. So they're very eager to see you respect them and cater to their needs, not just the negotiators and the official delegations, but also to the observers. They do add an important thing to the conference in terms of legitimacy, in terms of attention, and in terms of holding the negotiators accountable.
The high-level segment is when all the ministers, so at least 100, and several presidents come to the COP and spend 3 days either putting the last touches on whatever is agreed on. So it is, yes, it is a high point in the life of the COP.
There is a lot of tweaking takes place in the first week, so that when the ministers and the presidents and prime ministers are arriving, it's already a well-oiled machine, has been tweaked several times, and it's only then those high-level VIPs that are coming, their teams are already here on the ground, and they're able to easily have them adapt to the operation.
Every single country has different kind of protocol, and every single country has different things that for them is very important, and you try not to offend anybody, and understand, and at the same time that they understand you.
The high-level segment plays a very important role within the COP. In addition to the protocol and the presence of these leaders, it actually is the signal that the COP is ready to take some issues to a higher political level.
Planning, when we started, we looked at the figures from last year, and we said we need roughly working space for 1,500 journalists. From the TV side, TV radio, we have around 100 media organizations. We need a media center, so a place, a location for the media representatives to work. Nowadays, we have a lot of online reporting, so the journalists are becoming multimedia producers in a way. So they write text, they produce pictures, they produce films, and they need to shoot this out. And that's mainly happening in the media center. We also provide 2 press conference rooms. One press conference room is for delegations and United Nations organizations and IGOs, and the second one is only reserved for non-governmental organizations.
You will be amazed at the number of journalists that will travel to your event. And of course, what they report is the reality of what's going on. So it's important to cater to them. The threat is that these people will be very critical of course, the negotiations, but also of whether the host country is able to walk the talk. Are they able to host this event in a sustainable way? But it's also an opportunity. It is an amazing opportunity for any city, any country to have for 2 weeks, thousands of journalists arriving in your country with idle time on their hands to report about what a wonderful touristic destination or green solutions your country can offer. And they'll be very willing to have good ideas on what they can report about. So there's a good opportunity for showcasing your country also.
For the what we call the regular COPs, there is specialist media. They are media who specializes in environmental issues, and they're there, and they're there in numbers, and they understand what this is all about. And then there are situations where you have a COP like a conference like Copenhagen or like Paris, where it goes beyond just the specialists, no? Everybody then gets interested. And so, yes, it is a media spectacle, I would say, irrespective of the fact that it's a difficult subject. The ultimate goal is to combat the effects, is to combat climate change, and if not, the effects of climate change. If the logistics fail, the negotiations won't happen. And you can have the best logistics in the world, and the negotiations will still fail. So it cannot be about access control, it cannot be about registration, it cannot be about the interpreters walked out, it cannot be about there was no food, it cannot be about the microphones weren't working. That is a no-go. The conference cannot fail because the organizational team did not deliver.
In the aftermath, there are a lot of people that were disappointed that Copenhagen did not deliver on a legally binding international agreement as the hoper set out for. It did deliver some very specific results. But for us, as the logistical people, we did find ourselves very much in the same boat as the people dealing with the substance. The last few hours of the COP, we were all exhausted in the organizing team. Very exhausted, in fact. But we had placed a few bottles of champagne in the fridge to celebrate that everything had went according to plans, gone according to plans in terms of logistics. But a sad moment that really is clear in my memory is when one of my colleagues came to me and said, I guess now's the time we celebrate. And we just had to agree that this is no time for champagne. We did not achieve the results we hoped for in Copenhagen. So there was a little bit of a sad ending to the COP for us. And we were exhausted.
The one very funny thing that I have told several people about happened to me in Durban, COP 17. And I'm walking, you know, in my usual style, very, very quickly from one meeting to the next. And as I pass, or as I approach, I hear this very distinguished gentleman standing up against a big column, screaming into a cell phone. And he's going, no, I don't have time. I'm very, very busy here. And then somebody says something. And then he says, I said, I am very busy. I'm here in Durban at COP 71. And I listen to this and I go, oh my gosh, first, here's a dyslexic person just like I am who can never get their numbers straight. But more than that, we better make sure that we didn't ever have a COP 71, because that's at least 50 years from now. And if 50 years from now, we are still trying to agree on how we're going to solve this problem, then we have not done our job, right? So I thought, okay, I shall remember that forever, that we do never want to get to COP 71.
Things do get absurd from time to time. You are met with absolutely unreasonable demands from delegations. And if you can smile at that afterwards, it's good.
We work with our predecessors and try to understand what went well and what went wrong in their organizations and taking advantage of their benefits. We are going to make mistakes. And I think we are not going to be judged on our mistakes, but on our capacity to react on our mistakes.
You need to build up a strong relationship. You need to work so that everybody knows their counterpart, not just in a formal sense, but also in a personal way, and understands what the counterpart in either the host country or the UNFCCC need to deliver. What does it look like from their desk?
All the teams that I've worked with now, at the end of it, say that they've learned a lot, that they have enjoyed the experience and that it has enriched them.
If you ask the Danes, was this a good thing, I think most Danes would say, most members of parliament would probably say, that our little nation has to do everything we can to help in getting a global agreement on what we're going to do about climate change, the biggest challenge for our generation.
We hope that this video has helped you to understand better how much of a challenge hosting and organizing a COP represents. If you'd like further information, then the handbook that this video accompanies can be downloaded from the UNFCCC website, or you can contact us directly. And if your country is going to be hosting the next COP, we hope it's the best one yet. Good luck!